So let's just get right into what I learned from studying for over 500 hours for one exam. I made a slide deck for this video, just like my MCAT study guide. And if you haven't watched that video already, this is meant to serve as sort of a compliment. If you've been following my YouTube channel, you would know that I took the MCAT, or the Medical College Admissions Test. I learned a lot about test-taking strategies, how to study efficiently. Hopefully you can learn from some of my mistakes that I made along the way. So tip number one is to identify your weaknesses. It's really tempting to start off studying with your strengths because it feels easier, but it's really important to identify which topics you need to spend more time reviewing early on. So I'm gonna give you all some action items for each tip. Action item number one for identifying your weakness is to take a diagnostic. I thought that I needed to finish all of my content review before I could take a diagnostic because I wanted an accurate representation of where I was at. However, it's a diagnostic for a reason. You don't need to have all of your studying done. You're never going to feel 100% prepared to take that diagnostic. It's just meant to be as a guidepost to what to study in the future based off of the format of your exam. So while I initially thought, okay, the MCAT is going to be a lot of content, I didn't realize that a big portion of the exam is critical analysis, experimental passages, and I would have been able to adjust my studying appropriately if I had taken a diagnostic earlier on in my studying. If you don't have a diagnostic test available to you, you can still take steps to identify your weaknesses by going through the topics that are going to be tested. So for the MCAT, go through the AMC outline that has all of the topics that can be possibly covered on the exam. Literally spend one day just looking through the outline of all the topics and highlighting the ones that you know you struggle with the most. I don't know why I pushed this off for like over a month when I was studying for the MCAT, and it would have been so much more helpful if I did that in the beginning and then focused on those chapters or those topics in the beginning of my study process. So let's use an example. I'm studying for a physics exam. So I want you to rate all of your topics on the exam from a scale of 1 to 5. 1 being, oh my gosh, I'm praying this does not show up on my exam. And 5 being, this is a piece of cake and these are easy points for me. So once you have all of your topics outlined in a table like this and you've rated your comfortability, it's really easy for you to then sort your sheet by how difficult a topic is for you and then correspondingly write down the date up until your exam that you're going to study each topic. In this example, it's really clear we want to study chapter 1.4 and 2.1 because those are the most difficult. This system allows you to structure your study plan based on difficulty, and it takes away a lot of the guesswork and the pain that comes with making your study schedule and committing to it. So once you have this plan, it's a lot easier for you to just know what you're going to do that day instead of agonizing over, what should I study? Should I do this topic or this topic? So now with this action item, you've made a study plan that's ordered based off of what is most difficult for you. Tip number two is to not overlook the importance of sleep and exercise. When I was studying for the MCAT, I made sure that I got enough sleep so I wasn't groggy the next day, and it put me in a good mindset to study. And also, exercise is super important. You don't want to let the stress consume you. And also establish a good support system. So for me, I was deciding whether I should take the exam in Providence, back in college, or if I should go back home to study for the exam, depending on sort of like what would be lined up for me that summer. And because of the pandemic, I ended up staying home and I had my family around me, which ended up being a really important support system for me. So these are things that you should consider alongside actually preparing for the exam, trying to set yourself up for success by having proper sleep, exercise, and a good support system. Speaking of studying and exercise, I want to show you all a backpack I've been loving. I have been using this backpack to go to the gym. I got this backpack from Happy Teeth, and they are actually kindly sponsoring this video today. I love so many things about this backpack. There are more compartments than you could ever dream of. I love that there's a separate compartment that I can put my shoes or flip-flops in so it doesn't touch the rest of my clothes. And the best thing about this backpack is that it is super easy to clean. It is antimicrobial, and it was actually designed by a fellow YouTuber and dental hygienist, and she wanted to make a backpack that was specifically for healthcare professionals. And because it's designed for healthcare professionals, it's super functional. There are multiple compartments, it's easily cleaned, and if you've ever seen hospital floors, you definitely don't want that staying on your backpack. It's also super customizable to your lifestyle and your use case, so you can use it to travel, to go to the gym, or to bring to the hospital, whether you're scribing, a medical assistant, or a future doctor. I know a lot of you are pre-med or pre-health, and so I think you'd love this backpack. If you're interested, don't forget to use the code MAY20 for $20 off the backpack at checkout. So thank you again to Happy Teeth for sponsoring this video, and let's get back into tip number three, which is active recall. So initially, at the beginning of my content review for the MCAT, I was writing down handwritten notes. It was excessively time consuming. I never even read back any of my notes. And so I realized that I needed to change my study method. And this is just a quick aside, but if you notice that a study method is not working for you, change it. Don't keep doing it just for the sake of doing it. The most common flashcard applications are Anki and Quizlet. With Anki, there's a close function, which is essentially fill in the blank. You can also use it as a traditional front and back flashcard. I really like the image occlusion function, which allows you to cover up a structure or part of a pathway and then reveal the answer. Meanwhile, we have our tried and true Quizlet. It's really simple and intuitive to use, but it's kind of annoying to always type in the answer. So ultimately, use whatever works for you. Anki has a bigger learning curve, but I think there's a better payoff. And finally, we have paper flashcards. I'm not a huge fan. I just think that time can be spent better elsewhere. If you think, oh, but I want to draw structures that need to be handwritten, that's a sign that maybe using flashcards is not the best method for this topic. For example, if you're studying hormone pathways, you might want to make a concept map or a flow diagram instead of making flashcards. But then again, image occlusion would still work for Anki. Method two is using an Excel spreadsheet. So the first column would have your question, the second column would have your answer, but the key here is to turn the text in column two to white so you can't see it. That way when you flip back and forth, you're able to only reveal the answer if you hover over it. Another way to use this is to type in your answer to the question in column three and then reveal the answers at the end when you're done answering all of the questions. Tip number four is that the quality of your view is way more important than the quantity of practice tests that you take. So let's say we have two scenarios. The first scenario being that you have 10 practice tests, but you review them very poorly. You skim through the answers and you need the test question to actually be open in order to interpret the notes that you wrote about that question. Really, instead, you want to have the key takeaways concisely written out so that you can refer back to them without having to open the test back up again. On the other hand, you can take 4 practice tests, but outline your thought process and where you got stuck or made a mistake, and review the broader topic at hand. So again, writing concise takeaways on the broader topic and what you should take away from this question. So this might be, oh, I learned that I need to make this adjustment in my test taking strategy and read the question more carefully. Or for example, if you get a question wrong on, let's say, conflict theory, which is a sociological perspective, you would want to review other theories like symbolic interactionism, etc. So which is better? Definitely the one on the right, taking 4 practice tests and reviewing those thoroughly, really understanding where you went wrong, rather than just skimming through the answers and just trying to do as much practice as possible. You can find my templates for reviewing exams in my MCAT study video, which I will link in the cards above and also in the description box. So going into test taking strategies, tip number 5 is that you don't need to know the right answer to eliminate the wrong ones. And this was a super helpful test taking strategy for me. A lot of times the answer choices all sound kind of correct, so it's more difficult to justify why choice A is correct, for example. And for me, it was a lot easier to eliminate answer choices that I thought were just outright wrong. Process of elimination definitely saves you a lot of time agonizing over whether you chose the right answer. Most of the time you can eliminate down to 2 answer choices and then more confidently lean towards one of them. Another test-taking strategy would be to identify the differences between answers. So this is really helpful for if you have super long answer choices. Identify the key differences. So for example, if you have an imaginary question where if you heat up a solution, what happens? And the answer choices are the reaction shifts left and entropy increases, reaction shifts right and entropy decreases, etc. This example is more obvious where one part of the answer choice is about which direction the reaction shifts and the second part is whether entropy increases or decreases. In actual exams, it might be a little bit more difficult to identify because the answer choices are super long, but this is just to illustrate that test taking strategies can help you save a lot of time. Which goes into point number 6, which is that time is of the essence. If you don't know the answer, move on. this was probably one of the hardest lessons I had to learn when I was studying for the MCAT. If you don't know the answer, you need to exercise a little bit of self-control, leave behind the perfectionism, just flag the question and move on. Trust me, dwelling on the question for another 3 minutes and then panicking when you get to the last few questions at the end of the section is not going to be of benefit to you. So it's in your best interest to just put your best guess and then check your answer if you have time at the end. So I have a few bonus tips. Going off of the previous point, I try to finish each section early so I don't have this psychological feeling of I'm running out of time on the last passage. I also acknowledge that I would be really stressed during the first beginning part of the exam, and so I would just go through the first passage and acknowledge that I would get a lot of those questions wrong because I'm stressed, then save time for the end so I could calmly finish the last question, and then go back to the beginning and check my answers specifically for the first passage when I was really nervous. That was like a huge realization for me. Hopefully that helped someone. My last two bonus tips, thank you for making it this far into the video, and don't forget to like and share with someone who might find this helpful. But it is to go in with a timing strategy. So if you know how many questions are going to be on your exam, spend maybe 30 seconds at the beginning just to breathe and remember your timing. So a lot of test taking is really just employing time management and test taking strategies like process of elimination. So I literally wrote down my time checkpoints at the beginning of the MCAT so I wouldn't panic. So let's say you have 90 minutes for 60 questions. This would mean that at 60 minutes left, you should have 20 questions. And also for the MCAT science passages, if you run out of time, go straight to the figures and the graphs. Those are usually the most tested parts of the passage. To summarize what we talked about today, tip number one was to identify your weaknesses and structure your study schedule based off of what is most difficult for you. Front load the most difficult concepts. Two is that sleep, exercise, hobbies, and a strong support system, while not directly part of studying for your exam, do influence your preparation. So keep these things in consideration. Tip number three is active recall is far more efficient than taking handwritten or typed notes and then never reading them back again. Reading is super passive, so active recall is the way to go. Tip number four, the quality of a review is much more important than the number of practice tests that you take. Five, and possibly my most favorite tip, is that you don't need to know the right answer to eliminate the wrong ones, and this can get you very far. And finally, six, ditch the perfectionist tendencies. If you don't know the answer, just leave a guess and move on. You can always come back to it at the end. All right, that's gonna be it for this video. Thank you so much for watching. If you like this video, don't forget to leave a like, subscribe, and also if you have any questions, feel free to leave a comment or suggest something you want me to go more in depth on in a future video. And with that, happy studying, and I will see you in the next video. Bye. Tell me what I should be doing.